Hi everyone. In this video, I am going to take you through the detailed analysis of NMAT-23. Let's get started. Let's start with the overview of the test. Now, when it comes to NMAT, it's an adaptive test. It means that it adapts to the way you are performing on the test, and the difficulty level of the questions keeps fluctuating. So if you are answering questions correctly, the difficulty level goes up. If you are answering questions incorrectly, the difficulty level goes down, and this keeps on happening throughout the test. So the test was conducted in an adaptive format, and there was no option to skip questions. It means that you see only one question at a time. You cannot go back to a previously attempted question, or you cannot see a question palette so that you can choose which question you want to attempt. You can see only one question at a time. You have to answer that question, and then only you can move forward. If you click on the next button without selecting an option, you will see an error message, and the message is like this: you must complete your answer to this question to continue. So you have to answer the question before you can move on. Because of the adaptive format of the test, whatever we are going to discuss in this particular video in terms of the number of questions across each of the individual areas, that can always change. Somebody can get more questions from a particular topic, or somebody can get fewer questions from a particular topic. And that is why whatever we are discussing in terms of the number of questions in individual areas, please don't take that to be the exact number of questions that you can get on the test. Lastly, the instructions for the test mentioned that unattempted questions at the end of the section would attract a penalty. We don't know exactly how that penalty works and what is the extent of that penalty, but yes, there is a penalty for not completing the section. So for example, in a particular section where you have 36 questions, for some reason, let's say you are able to attempt only 32 questions and you could not see the last four questions, there will be a penalty that will be involved and your score will drop simply because you were not able to complete the section. So it is important that you complete all the sections and pace yourself nicely in the individual sections. Let's talk about the test structure now. So the test structure didn't change from the previous years. It was 36 questions in the language, 36 questions in quant, and 36 questions in the logical reasoning section. For the individual sections, the time limit that was allotted was 28 minutes for the language section, 52 minutes for the quant, and 40 minutes for the logical reasoning section, making it a 120 minute or a 2 hour paper. An option to decide section attempt order was presented to students at the start of the test. So you can decide in which order you want to attempt, whether you want to do, say, language first, then quant and then LR, or you want to follow some other order, for example, a quant, language, LR. So you can choose that order. You have 3 minutes to decide in which order you want to take the test. Now let's start with the individual sections. I'm going to start with quant. In quant, there were 24 questions on problem solving, 8 questions from data interpretation, and 4 questions from data sufficiency. Again, as mentioned in the beginning of the video, the distribution that you see here can change because the test is adaptive in nature. So don't take this to be the exact number that you might get on the test. From modern math, there were 3 questions on probability, 3 on P&C, logarithms, 2 questions, and 2 questions from arithmetic and geometric progressions. Overall, the number of questions that you see from this area was the largest. So modern math had a total of 10 questions, and the questions were time consuming. So overall also, if you look at the quantitative skills section, the difficulty was slightly higher compared to the previous year. It was a little lengthy, I would say, rather than saying the actual questions were difficult, because the questions demanded a lot of calculations. In arithmetic, 3 questions from SICI, 4 from percentage, 1 from time and work, partnerships, and profit and loss each. From numbers, there were 2 questions, and from algebra, 1 question each on quadratic and algebraic formulae. Regarding DI sets, there were 2 DI sets. The paper in which I appeared had 1 set on bar plus line graph and 1 set on table. Of course, you can have different kinds of sets. Some of you may get set with incomplete information, some of you may get a set on Venn diagram, and so on. Regarding data sufficiency, it was a mixed bag. So there were 4 questions based on numbers and arithmetic. Overall, when we look at the quant section, the scaling is generally severe. It means that people tend to score on the lower side when you look at the quant as a section. And because the test has become slightly difficult, the quant section has become slightly difficult, there could be some impact on the sectional cutoff. But we'll talk about that towards the end of the video. Now let's talk about the logical reasoning section. So in this section, there were 21 questions from verbal reasoning and 15 questions on non-verbal reasoning. This was a deviation from last year, wherein there were 24 questions of verbal reasoning and 12 questions of non-verbal reasoning. Let's talk about the individual components now. So there were questions on assumptions and conclusions. There were 3 such questions. Strong and weak argument identification. There were 2 questions based on this. On course of action, you had 4 questions and 1 question on facts. Critical reasoning overall, which is strengthening the argument, weakening the argument, and so on, there were total 9 questions. So this is the most dominant part of the entire section. Regarding syllogisms, there were 2 questions, fairly straightforward questions is what I had. And then arrangements, there was 1 set of 4 questions and there was 1 standalone question on arrangements. Regarding sequential output, most of the students that I spoke to had 2 sets of 4 questions. Even I had 8 questions in total, which were 2 sets of 4 questions each. And regarding logical and numerical puzzles, there were 2 standalone questions from this area. Overall, the difficulty of this particular section was very similar to what it has been previously. So if you look at the last few years, the difficulty of the LR set didn't really change much, though there was change in the composition of non-verbal and verbal reasoning questions. So you can expect the cutoff to remain pretty similar. Now let's talk about the third and the final section, which is the language skills. There were 8 questions from reading comprehension and 28 questions from verbal ability. Regarding reading comprehension, there were 2 passages of 4 questions each, and the passages were a little difficult to read. Though they were not very lengthy, the typical length was about 4 to 5 paragraphs, but the topic or the subject of those RCs was something which was very difficult to read. Regarding parajumbles, either you had 4 sentence parajumble or 5 sentence parajumble. There were total 6 questions based on parajumbles. As it has been the case previously, there were a lot of questions from vocabulary. So analogies based, there were 6 questions. Fill in the blanks, vocab based, there were 6 questions. And fill in the blanks, preposition based, there were 4 questions. Spotting the error, which is essentially grammar, there were 6 questions based on this. Regarding the overall difficulty of the language skills section, it was very similar to what it has been in the last few years. And that is why the cutoff won't change too much. Now let's talk about the score. So once you submit the test, immediately on screen, you will be able to see your scale score. But of course, there was a problem this time. There was a glitch in the language skills section, because of which people saw score which was more than 120. So quant score was fine, the LR score was fine, but suddenly in the language skills section, a lot of students saw score above 120, which also translated into total score being above 360. Of course, this is a technical glitch and I'm assuming that it's something that will get fixed very soon and they will be re-releasing the scorecards. Regarding the official scorecard, it can be downloaded from the student dashboard. Lastly, let's talk about the cutoffs. Now, what I'm showing you on screen is the cutoff from last year for NMIMS for various campuses. Now, if you look at the Mumbai campus, the cutoff was 232, the sectional was 71, 76 and 69. If you look at the reported difficulty of the individual sections this year, we don't see a lot of changes in terms of the sectional or the overall cutoff that was there. However, quant section is something wherein because a lot of students are finding it difficult, there could be some impact. But of course, this is something that we cannot comment on at this point of time. We'll have to wait, and as we progress in the test window, once we have more data, we'll be able to give some indication on what the probable cutoffs could be. I hope this video has helped you and it has given you a nice overview of what happened in NMAT 23. If you have any question, feel free to drop a comment and we'll try to get back to you at the earliest. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe to the channel if you haven't done it already. And I hope to see you in the next video. Till then, all the best.